All right, we welcome back to Ctrl+ART+Del, the podcast about the art industry, being an artist, and collecting art for the next generations. We're here with Ken Yarus, Richie Carter, myself, Morgan Cawdrey, Lauren Verardo, Dan Williams, our producer, and our special guest, Nate Closson, this week, hopefully a recurring guest. The show this week is brought to you by Heart of the West Art Show, which all Ken, Richie, and Nate are exhibiting artwork at in Coeur d'Alene, September 1st through 4th at the Coeur d'Alene Resort in Idaho. The topic for this week's podcast is the tools of the trade. They're going to talk a little bit about oil painting and all the things necessary to creating a beautiful piece of artwork, broken down into sort of what you're putting on the canvas, what you're putting the paint on, as in the canvas, and what you're using to put that medium on the canvas. And so I wanted to start with Ken. Ken was going to has a very interesting little setup of keeping his oil paints fresh for long periods of time, which is a really thrifty way to do oil painting. It's an expensive medium, and it hurts a lot to throw it out when it dries out, which can happen pretty quickly if you don't take care of it. So Ken, you want to talk about what you're working on and what you're working with?
Yeah, sure thing, Morgan. So I do specialize in trying to be thrifty as I can and budget so I can be a professional painter. And this little device I made, which I'll show the camera here, is a palette style that allows me the most flexibility possible with, I think, conserving the paint the best. Of anything I've seen, a lot of people use a stay wet palette and they work pretty well, but they're a little clumsy, I feel like, and they literally limit my working space. I have a large table I paint on now that's all glass. And with that, if I had my stay wet palette on there, it was a really small working space still. So these allow me a lot more flexibility. And I'll explain mostly how it works to save paint. Get that thing adjusted there. When I am done painting, or even if I'm working on a limited palette, only using a few colors, I can put these lids on there, and it keeps air from really circulating over the paint, which keeps the oil film from filming over, and then I can keep it fresh that regard. I can also take them off. They're just magnetized onto a steel rod or a steel plate that, again, I can easily pick up and stick in the freezer. It's really narrow and small. I can switch out different capsules for different colors if I want to switch out different colors I want on my palette. So it's totally flexible in that regard, easy to clean. If these get really, really nasty, which I've been using this paint for, I guess, about 6 months now, and it's still wet. No, I haven't had to throw any paint away yet. But if I will, I could just buy another one of these containers for, I think they're $1.80 off of thebeadstore.com. They're made for little girls' beads or something. I repurposed them, and now I can...
Boys like beads sometimes.
Yeah. So you can get it anywhere you want, any gender you are. But this is the best purpose I found for them, and I can just keep it really... keep paint for a really long time, so far anyway. So I'm really happy with the system I finally came together with that.
Was that an original system? Or did you... have inspiration? Or?
No, I would just been thinking about how to create it so it stays safe. And some of the other artists I know will use Saran wrap and just put it over paint on their palette, but it's usually messy because you can take that off and you just oil paints everywhere. And I'm kind of OCD, obviously. Mm-hmm. And so this kind of.
Tell by the way you're knocking four times every time you enter the room.
it's escalating these days. Yeah. I need to try to keep it under control, but this really fulfills my OCD need with paint, and I think it encouraged me to find this system because I was using, I said, the stay wet palette, but it would get really nasty. Every, you know, a few months you'd have to clean everything out, and just you'd be sitting there for hours with a dirty razor blade trying to get crusty paint off, and that's not fun. So
what's a stay wet palette?
It's basically a plaster. It's more actually for acrylic paint, but it's a big plastic tray. Actually, hold on, I might have mine right here. Hang on. Oh, I do! Look at it. It probably still has the dirty old paint in it.
Nice.
This is it. Yeah, sorry. You haven't thrown it away yet, because that's sentimental value. But this thing, so it's got the lid on top,
okay.
That it basically keeps air off of it when you want to put it in the freezer. And that's traditional. Like, that's the best way to keep oil paint alive for a long time is to freeze it, because the oils don't coagulate very much. Oh, I guess they are frozen solid, but they'll thaw out pretty quick. So this is what I had before. So you can see all the colors were where they were. I couldn't rearrange them if I wanted to. They would dry into disgusting concrete, and you'd have to scrape this all off. I taped it to try to make it easier, and even that would wear out after a while. But my working zone is maybe 11 by 14. It's not enough space for me now. I like to have a lot more mixing room on my palette, because I use a palette knife most of the time to mix paint. And yeah, so this thing's heading to the dump. Well, actually, it's probably not allowed to the dump, because it's chemical waste. So I'll probably burn it in my yard.
Just tell us if you'll figure it out, please.
I'll figure it out. I won't do anything incriminating, but I will. It is frustrating, though, to have to dispose of paint unnecessarily, because it is chemical waste, actually, and it, I mean, not all chemicals in the paint are bad, but it's something to be aware of, if you can minimize that
all
environmentally.
All the footballs and stuff, but a lot of bad.
Yeah, you wouldn't want to eat any of it, and I wouldn't want to feed it to my sheep or anything else. I'm just trying to keep it out of the realm of things eating it. So this is the best way I've figured out to really keep paint safe, and it allows me also to really stay organized with my colors. I can, like I said, if I want to rearrange them, I can. If I introduce new colors, I can, without any hassle at all. And I guess I'll lead into what I paint with color-wise. I have a pretty big palette for the moment. I mean, it's not humongous, but I've got 12 colors, including white, which isn't really a color, but and black. And a lot of them are new to me this year. I've been trying to really experiment with colors and which ones are the most versatile is kind of what I'm doing with the palette right now. And traditionally, artists have used a huge array of colors, and usually a limited array of colors. A lot of the old masters only used 3 or 4 colors, so to have 12 is a little obscene sometimes. But I don't use all 12 in every painting. If I can avoid it, I generally work limited with all the colors I have. And I think a big solution to understanding what you have to work with and what your colors are capable of is to do color charts. Which, again, I decided on this palette and then decided to do a full two weeks of work setting up all the color charts, which was a big deal. And I think.
But you only have to do it once.
Yeah, you only have to do it once. I mean, if you had a new color, though, you'd, in theory, have to make a whole new chart just for that color. But
how many did you do?
I did all 12 that I have here. Well, I did 11 without doing white, because white's mixed into everything automatically.
Can you describe the color charts?
Yeah, I'll show them to people here and try to explain which one I'll start with here. Ultramarine blue is probably one of the more steadfast colors in painters' palettes. It's been around for a while and people just default to it as a really wonderful blue. But you can see the first column is ultramarine blue added white to 5 values. So it's not too, I mean, some artists will do more values than that, just so you can really see the range is capable of in tone or in value, but I just did the 5 because I felt it's plenty for that. And after that, you're mixing it with every color on your palette and adding white to it. So you're gonna see what, if you add ultramarine blue to, like I use yellow ochre, this is the scale I can look at for what it'll do. Indian yellow is that one, and I just went up from basically my warmest, I mean, yellow ochre is not really my warmest color, but it was probably the lightest yellow I had, all the way to ivory black at the end, and I set up every color chart accordingly. So here's quinacridone red, added with white, and then mixed from yellow ochre all the way back to ivory black. So you can have a kind of consistent thing. And that is where a cat stepped on it with wet paint on his foot.
What does quinacridone indicate? Like when
I don't even know if I'm pronouncing it right. I've heard people pronounce it other ways. I'm really good at mispronouncing words.
I think that's right.
It's a part of my personality. But yeah, sorry, what was your question about it?
Do you know what it signifies? Like, what is quinacridone?
Quinacridone, as far as what I know about quinacridone, is it's a more modern color. It was made in like the 50s, I think. It was one of like more chemical reds. It's not like cadmium is an older color, I think. I haven't done hard research on it. I just know that it's traditionally not like.
So the impressionists didn't have it.
I don't think so. No, it's definitely more modern. You can tell it's got out of control saturation.
Right. Yeah.
And it's really bright. Whereas, say, like yellow ochre is a more earth tone, that's what it's capable of. And Indian yellow, which actually is a more authentic, it's an older color. It used to be made with camel's urine.
Really?
I think it was camel's urine that was, they fed them a certain leaf in India, and it would taint the urine very vibrant yellow, and apparently it was very bad for the animals and they would die. They don't make it that way now, but
that was the kind of crazy story behind it, but it's
a very vibrant yellow. It's out of control in its saturation. So I picked colors like quinacridone red and Indian yellow, and I have phthalo green and phthalo blue, and the phthalo colors are ones that traditionally people said, you know, don't touch, you know, it's like flying a jet engine, and if you don't know what you're doing, you're going to fly off out of the control. And I feel like I still do that quite a bit.
Except you won't die.
Yeah, nothing will die, but you just won't make any money, and no one will like your paintings, and it's just hard to be in that boat, too. So I did these color charts as a way to understand the colors a lot better and know that they are capable of doing different things. Yeah. And ultimately, my theory is, I guess, that you can go to this level of saturation, but you can always gray it down. And if you look at this chart here, it goes from this crazy saturation level here, and even with all that white, it's super saturated. But over here, with black in it, it really becomes just a gray color.
Right.
And it's a beautiful gray, because it holds so much saturation, you can carry it into lots of things and tint things really well. So it's more versatile than, say, a yellow ochre. If you look at this chart, there's no variation at all. You know, it's always yellow ochre on some level. Even if you're adding black, it's just kind of a grayish green. But you really need these colors sometimes. Yellow ochre is one of my favorite colors. It's just that it's cool to accent it with some of these really more powerful colors. And again, I feel like I never really studied painting in school. I studied mostly drawing. And I never got a formal color education, so this is all still something I'm self-teaching a little bit and trying to just do the best I can. So
my mom and I just finished ours this last week.
Really?
Our color charts. Yeah, we used the Richard Schmidt palette.
Oh man, that's a big palette too. There's a lot of colors.
It was 12. It was 12 different color charts, and yeah, it's hard to do. It's like mentally demanding to just kind of keep.
What do you feel like you gained from it, I guess?
I would love to use them in plein air painting, just to be able to look at a color and then look at my charts and find that in the charts and then be able to reproduce that, hopefully, immediately, rather than having to play around with different mixtures. And
especially plein air painting, where you're really fighting time.
I've
only plein air painted one time with these since then, and I have found it really difficult because I was trying to hold the color charts up and thinking about what they were, and you can't really do that in nature because there's always light bouncing everywhere that the color on the color charts really isn't going to be nothing, just because it'll be darker always. And we used them in still lives for a while to practice, and that really helped because the lighting is more controlled.
Mm-hmm.
This wasn't getting hit with bright sunlight, and that wasn't hit with bright sunlight. Everything was kind of controlled. But what I really gained a lot from it is when I go, plein air painting, I'll try to take notes and say like what the color kind of was, and then I can come back here and look at my color charts a little bit more. And I'll try to do it more in plein air.
Uh-huh.
I was hoping it'd be like my miraculous like breakthrough, but it's been actually better while I'm in the studio, because I've been able to contemplate what I want to harmonize more. And painting, I'm gonna start it here shortly in front of everybody here. I basically designed the colors entirely from the color charts. I didn't work at all from a reference for it. I designed the picture from sketches and basically what I wanted to say with the painting, which is kind of homage to an old country song. And I don't know, I went a little creative. I don't really do that very often. More naturalistic, I usually paint from life. And so this is kind of an experimentation, but to really just design the colors up. I had the color study done now, so I'll show the camera that. Those were just color. I would have never used that kind of purple in the sky. But because I was looking at the color charts, I could really compare the yellows and purples and different. You could just fold them over each other and put the colors next to each other.
Yeah, they look next to each other.
And like, see, it's like, wow, that actually looks really interesting and dynamic. So that was fun to use the color charts in something that I guess I wasn't prepared. I didn't expect that from doing them.
Uh-huh.
So
learning.
Yeah, breakthroughs.
And you mentioned a really interesting kind of hidden tool of the trade, which is lighting. And it makes all the difference, because painting something out in the bright sunlight, when you go to try to hang that in the house with who knows how somebody lights their walls, it can look entirely different and not look at all what you hoped it looked like. So,
also, if you're plein air painting, the general rule or something you watch for, and you can try to tell people that do more plein air painting from other people that don't, maybe, is that they'll set up directly in the sunlight with their painting getting hit with sunlight. And that's just like, when you're fighting, you're taking an already very difficult task,
right,
and then making it way harder on yourself. So it's when you tilt it into the shade, you're getting a lot more neutral light. And
right. What about overcast days? Is that better for plein air, do you think?
Well, it's good for painting under, but it's terrible for painting. It's always kind of boring, so it's.
Yeah,
I don't try to go out too much on overcast days, but it is nice because nothing will change. You can really do more meditative, contemplative studies because it's not going to be gone in 5 minutes. Like around here, you get beautiful clouds rolling around and patchwork over the mountains, and that's the stuff I want to paint, but it's gone instantaneously. So it's. But those days, you want to tilt it away from the sun and try to control as much of your environment as you can. But some people use umbrellas, but I found like they blew my whole setup over so many times.
Very dangerous.
Yeah. Giant parachute.
And do you use any like mixing medium, like linseed oil I've used to extend oil and make it kind of more buttery?
I used to use some oil, depending on the paint I'm using, there's always a medium that's in the paint. And sometimes it's linseed oil, like I was using the M&H Graham, I think it was the name of the company, and they were using walnut oil as their medium in the paint, so I bought walnut oil to mix in with it, because I didn't want to introduce more things.
Right.
I've heard that like chemically now, and I'm not by any means a chemist, but one of the rules of thumb I've kind of picked up a little bit of things is like the more you're adding to the paint, the more likely it's going to become unstable chemically, I guess.
In the future?
Yeah, theoretically, I guess. So you're adding more crazy chemicals that may or may not do something bad. But if it's not in there, then you're just trusting these paint companies at this point. Back in the day, you'd have to know it yourself. But
right.
I don't know what's in all these paints, really. They do. And since I'm mixing companies now, I use different brands for different paints. It's kind of a chemical concoction that might end up poorly. Like Alizarin Crimson was probably one of the more recent ones that they found was unstable and literally flakes and falls off. Yeah. And they've had to change it now. There's now a cold Alizarin Permanent, but you should watch for that and buy it. I don't use Alizarins at all now because of that. But it was a real scary kind of thing for people using this beautiful color, thinking it's great. Richard Schmidt was one of them. And you need to buy Alizarin Permanent because it's will fail, it will fade, or if you're adding weird oils or additives, it could work, or it could yellow. I looked at an old painting from a few years ago that I used excessive amounts of oil in, because I was trying to glaze, and it's yellow, there's little drip pick marks all over the place, it's awful, the painting is ruined. And that kind of scared me a little bit from adding more stuff to my paint. And I like to paint thicker, so if the more I'm thinning it down, the more likely I'm going to already keep my wispy, wussy painting technique. I want to man up, just throw that expensive paint on there.
Don't they say kind of paint thin to thick?
Yeah. So I do work a little turpentine in when I'm blocking things in sometimes.
Uh-huh.
But if I'm working with these smaller pieces, it really helps me. So I feel like I can do some of the contemplative stuff. I can play around a little bit more. And then when it comes to making this actual painting, I'm ready just to put on thick paint. Like I don't even have to do value block-ins. I know what I'm doing. I have the paint picked out. My color charts will tell me exactly what this is, and there's no longer reason to just push things around. But when I'm working plein air, I use more turpentine. And the cool thing when you're working outside, that turpentine will air out a little better.
Dry faster.
It'll dry faster. You're also not breathing it in as much.
Right.
And here, if I leave the turpentine open, it's fumigating into my small studio that I'm not really getting enough air circulation in. So.
Right. Yeah, my mom bought a air purifier thing that she runs when she's painting oil, otherwise she gets really bad headaches. And
yeah, well, Richie, you get your throat really flares up, right?
I get a cough and stuff from, I don't know what it's from, but it's not good.
It's toxic. A lot of toxins in these
Britney Spears singles.
Yes.
I love that one.
That was a great song. Yeah, the cobalt, all those chemicals, or I guess they're minerals from deep under the earth.
Yeah, you don't want to get them in your skin, and you don't want to be breathing them in. Sanding paintings is the biggest no-no, because it's really airborne.
Yeah.
And I heard somebody talk about, basically the lead molecule is so big that, everyone used to really freak out about lead white, and they still do. But someone's like, unless it's, directly absorbed into your skin, the molecule's too big to just absorb naturally. But if you're using mineral spirits, that'll thin it down enough that it'll get into your skin more efficiently. I don't know, but I don't use it. I don't really care to. But it's a I think there's a lot of discussion and a lot of unknowns now than there ever has been in materials, because there's just so much you can get and there's so much variation in it.
Right.
So I don't know really what the...
What kind of white do you use?
I use titanium white.
Okay.
And it's traditionally, I guess it goes the lightest in value than the other whites. They're all slightly darker than that, was what I was kind of told in school about the different whites. Titanium white was... They can tint the lightest into the colors and stuff like that. The other ones will lose their strength.
I was just reading an article on Business Week, I think, about Bloomberg Business, and it's about the titanium white process, the process of making the pigment, and that it's like heavily protected by DuPont and chemical company, and that Chinese American employee stole the process and took it back to the Chinese government.
So my paint's gonna get a lot cheaper soon.
Well, they used and it's crazy because my wife Avis's dad works for mining companies that mine Trona, which I think is the root of titanium white. It's this white like chalky substance that they use for all sorts of things, including like detergent and it's basically filler. It's like soda ash.
Okay.
But I think at least they use part of that for creating this titanium white, and I'm not sure what's wrong with that, but
they don't use titanium.
No. Well,
wait,
actually,
why is it called that? Because titanium isn't white.
It's titanium dioxide. Dioxide is
okay.
So I don't know. I didn't finish the
article. I'm gonna read that now. You know about this.
Yeah, I know a lot of artists that really know their stuff, and it's always, I would say, it's kind of intimidating, but it's really impressive when they will really spend the time to really invest in that. And it's unfortunate, like, art schools anymore do not care at all. I mean, like, it's just like, buy whatever you want.
Yeah.
Run them cheapest, whatever. Like, they, to understand the chemicals is like the farthest thing, which is pretty crazy. A lot of the old masters, like, knew they had to go dig half the chemicals up out of the ground.
Right.
Or find the camels and feed them those weird leaves. Like, whatever you wanted to do, you find a way to do it. And we're really spoiled.
Pee
but
for me. Just one little drop. This painting's almost done.
It'd be miserable. I'm really glad I have Nick Blake and Jerry's Artorama and all the college art stores. And yeah, we're spoiled, but I feel pretty ignorant a lot of the times, really, when it comes down to what's in them. I know kind of what they do now. I've learned that, but to really know in 150 years if this painting will still be here, there's no way we can really say that. They'll say, oh, it's archival, or it's acid-free, or these things, but there's so many other crazy chemical variables now, especially after World War I and World War II, where basically man started making stuff then, thanks to mustard gas. Now we have oil paint.
And now I remember what my point was, is that the titanium white produced in the U.S. is made from organic materials from the earth, and the Chinese version is synthetic.
Oh,
and cheaper, but much worse for the environment as far as producing it goes. So
that's funny how that works out.
Classic China.
Yeah, classic industry. This is cheaper, but it's gonna kill a lot of stuff.
Do you think? I feel like the apprenticeship programs of earlier times in the art world, like that doesn't seem to be as much the case now as people do apprenticeships for anything, but
yeah.
It seems like that a lot of that knowledge could be passed down from a master who you're apprenticing under. Not the archival part, I guess, but
I mean, you'd probably, as the apprentice, you're probably spending good part of your beginning time mixing all those paints, so knew them before you ever touched the paintbrush, you know.
Yeah, they had
nobody even knows how to do that. That'd be.
There's some cool companies. They research it.
Yeah.
I think it's called Vasari, and they're a paint company. And they came to the Grand Central Academy of Art when I studied there to do a demo, basically, of why their paint rocks and other paint doesn't. And they did it. They illustrated it right on canvases in front of everybody by just mixing different colors together and thinning it with turpentine, so you could really see how much more pigment went into the paint. Because now they do add all kinds of fillers. Like, it's not all... Right. If you're buying a $8 tube of paint, it's one of these huge tubes. Like, it's not all pigment. You're going to use that whole tube where you could use just a little tiny tube of this Fusari paint because there's way more pigment in it. Huh. And they do a lot of research. And they were, like, I don't know, sketchbook and notes somewhere from when they were there. But it was so much information so fast that a lot of it didn't even stick in my head. But it was... It really just unsettled me in the whole debate, I guess, of materials. It's like, I have no idea. And most people don't. And to really find some people that do, like, they spend full-time jobs researching oil paint and other mediums even. I mean, like, because oil paint's just one medium. And the fact that watercolors have changed a lot in the years. And it's just, it's really cool. It's very fascinating, but kind of intimidating.
Yeah.
I'm not a chemist.
Are there any brands that you gravitate towards?
I like Gamblin quite a bit. There's a couple colors from Gamblin that I don't use, but Gamblin is one that I do think they do a lot of research, and they're just a little more affordable than some of the actual handmade painters. If I had more money, I would be buying something that was handmade, but I just don't yet. And that's the unfortunate thing for a lot of those paint companies is they're still working, trying to reach a broader market, but it is just a better product that costs a lot more. Same with Lamborghinis. I wish I had one of those. It was a lot faster in my truck, but it's a...
Not great in the snow.
Yeah, they wouldn't be very good near Montana, but yeah, Gamblin is probably my go-to paint color, my go-to company. I use some Winsor & Newton stuff. I've used some Lucas colors, which are like a really old German company that I actually borrowed some, or Josh Elliott gave me some last time I was over at their studio, and it was just interesting to use, but that stuff is just like pretty cheap paint. It doesn't cost a lot. But he was like, yeah, just use it some and see what you think. And I used some of that. Now I think mostly it's either Winsor & Newton or Gamblin, mostly because it's the easiest thing to buy up here. And I don't order paint very often, so I got
it. My mom, Nancy Cawdrey, said she still has paint from her days in Paris in the 60s.
Really?
Cool. She's been stingy with it, I guess.
Or it's really good paint. It goes a long way.
Secret saved Paris paint.
Well, cool. Thanks, Ken.
That's all right.
Thank you.
Meanwhile, Richie's been laying out a beautiful scene in what color would you call that?
What color?
Well, what are you doing right now?
Well, I just kind of finished I did a nice wash over it, and then I finished the underdrawing, just some little bit line drawing, so I can have some
reference,
little roadmap to go from. Now I'm just putting in the first bit of color and trying to match it. I did a study of this yesterday on a smaller scale.
Can you show the camera?
Yeah, it'll show a bit.
Very, really captures a smoky summer day for me on the flathead.
It's exactly what it is. Yeah.
Good.
It was about a month last summer when we just had a ton of smoke, but made for some fun painting.
Yeah, beautiful. Beautiful skies, beautiful sunsets.
Oh yeah,
it's like LA with all the smog.
Yeah.
So, like the room.
So Richie was going to talk a bit about what you put the paint on. So how do you prepare a canvas, the stretcher bars?
So I'm painting, this is what I try to paint most of my larger studio pieces on, which is Belgian linen, Closson's Belgian linen.
Closson.
Yeah, it should be sponsored by them. So I actually build my own panel, which is a crate. I'm going to take this off so you can see. It's 3-inch pine, it's hollow on the back, and then it's got a birch piece of plywood underneath. And then I take the linen and I actually adhere it to the panel. Part of that is, you know, my own personal preference. I like painting on some sort of linen or canvas. I like the tooth, that kind of even grid. And this is, I can't remember what number this is. I think it's like 15 or something. So it's kind of a medium weave. And it just has a nice texture to it that I like. But I also like painting on something that's rigid. So, you know, canvas that might have just stretcher bars that stretched over it, kind of has that give to it. I prefer it to be rigid on painting. And I've heard, you know, kind of what all the stuff that Ken's been talking about, it's like you can hear so many people's different artists take on their materials and what's important, and some people know a lot about it, they've done a lot of research, a lot of people don't know much about it. And I found, like, even with the surface you're painting on, just a big array of what people say you should do and shouldn't do. And one thing I did hear and that I've kind of stuck to is painting on a rigid surface is one of the most archival ways to paint. So it's not going to flex as much. You know, when you stretch a canvas, it loses a lot of its strength pretty quickly. And so, you know, obviously we're talking about paintings to be around for hundreds of years.
I think. That's what you mean by archival?
Yeah, yeah. And so, I mean, just with the materials that have really come out in more modern time, we don't know how long they're going to last, but we do have a, you know, running knowledge of all these.
Yeah, and painters. A rigid surface can't bend or.
Yeah, it's not going to bend and flex.
Yeah.
If it's canvas, I've heard to, you know, adhere it to a board, and it can, you know, it's going to be rigid and it's going to keep its strength. You're never stretching it. So,
what do you use to adhere it?
It's called Miracle Muck, actually. It's a.
Miracle Muck.
Miracle Muck. Yeah, it's a miracle. It's just a, like a non-acidic adhesive. I've heard like the MoMA and stuff will use it in a lot of museums and stuff. So it's and I talked to Derek actually, who does Ken's framing.
Derek Vanderberg at Frame of Reference.
Yeah.
Great framer.
Yeah. So he also recommended it to me.
That's good. I've heard horror stories of people trying to mount a like a probably a canvas piece and using just, you know, cheap glue or something and absolutely ruining it.
Yeah, that would be
a masterwork.
Terrible.
It's not what the framers intended.
No.
Yeah. So actually, when I adhere it, it's like the first time I did it, I was terrified because I'm using this huge piece of expensive linen, and I think I did like a 3x3 foot panel. And I should have probably started smaller, but I basically rolled on the Miracle Muck, and then I have a giant glass panel that I'll, you know, put the canvas on and get all the bubbles out, and then I put the glass panel on top of that so it keeps it all nice and kind of pressed together while it dries. It takes like a day to dry, and then I take it off and trim it around the edges, and voila.
As far as Belgian linen goes, what's the advantage of that? How is it different from your basic American linen or American?
Well, the Belgians are, I mean, they've been doing, they're kind of famous for their linen and their textiles, so, I mean, they've just been creating this for a really long time. It's,
gotcha.
It's apparently.
Is it actually made in Belgium, or is it like,
you know, that's actually a good question. I don't know for sure. I don't know. Kind of like beer, it could be. German style made over here, but you know, yeah, that's actually a good question.
How long do you think they've been masters of linen?
Oh, I can't even answer that.
Take a guess.
I'm gonna say 7,000 years.
Cool.
No, maybe
right down the road,
I would say really maybe like from like the. I mean, they're probably making sails and all sorts of stuff way for hundreds of years.
Way go, what do they say in that movie?
A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away.
Oh, Tom Hanks movie, I don't know.
Oh.
The future speak? Oh, dang it. Cloud Atlas.
Yeah.
Some weird word.
Yeah.
Your name's goofy.
Okay, so, and Richie, you're using a similar system as Ken, but plastic.
Oh yeah, it is as well a bead thing. Well,
beads
container. Or this one's just plastic. They're all connected. It's really great for taking plein air.
Uh-huh.
Just put all my colors in here. I work with a pretty limited palette when I'm plein airing for sure. I just have
what colors?
Ultramarine blue, cadmium red, cadmium yellow, medium cadmium lemon, and then I have a burnt sienna and a titanium white as well. So
the basics.
Yep, pretty much the basics.
So kind of two of every.
Yeah, the yellow one's really the yellow. I have kind of a cool and a warm yellow. Everything else is pretty much just one blue, one red.
One primary color.
Yeah, the primary.
Here, your burnt sienna is kind of a modifying.
Yeah, burnt sienna, I'll use it to get some of the darks, the darker darks with some.
And you don't, do you use black at all?
I don't have it on my plein air palette really, but I just did my color charts and I kept black in there, and black is also one of those colors that people are like, don't use black, don't ever.
Yeah.
And you know, black is essentially like a blue. So if you use it as a blue, you're not gonna just darken things with it, you know. Because I think that's what a lot of people do. They'll just be like, oh, there needs a shadow there, I'm gonna put black in it.
Right.
So it just becomes this kind of dull gray, one dimensional thing. So I've been using it as a blue, and I've actually been, I did a painting of snow, and I was doing some, the highlight Alpenglow, actually. And I used my color chart, and I was like, okay, what color is gonna get this the closest with the fewest amount of mixtures? And it was ivory black, just a little bit of ivory black and some cadmium yellow and one other thing, maybe some cadmium red and a lot of white. It made like a bright snow color with ivory black. So yeah, I just started using ivory black.
Ivory black color, wow.
It was, I would never have tried that if I didn't look at my color chart. That's pretty cool.
That's awesome. Anything else about the canvas or?
Be priming.
So it's primed. This I buy oil prime, so it already has the oil primer over it.
As opposed to
like an acrylic gesso. I don't put any gesso over the top of that. And
gesso.
So yeah, it's a little slick because it is oil prime, so it is a bit slick. And I don't know if it would be better to put my own gesso over the top, but I've been painting on it just like this, and I like it, so it works well.
It's cool. Yeah, people paint on all sorts of crazy surfaces. Canvas is the most common, but boards.
Yeah, wood paneling, just straight. I do that.
Super slippery,
yeah.
I imagine.
Yeah, it is a bit, much slippery.
The tooth on canvas is nice. I was looking at a woman's work online yesterday that was brushed aluminum. She paints right on brushed aluminum.
Yeah, I've seen people paint on copper.
Mm-hmm. What do you mean, woman's work?
A woman.
I've seen people paint on, I read an article, I can't remember who the artist was, but they're painting on marble, like veneers of marble.
Wow.
And they're doing these beautiful rendering, figurative, you know, portraits and stuff. And they let a lot of that marbling show through. And you'd look at it, you'd never think marble from, you know, distance or anything, and the quality, the effect that they got underneath, you would never actually get if you weren't using, if they weren't using that surface, it would be
right. Like polished marble?
Yeah, I think so. They had to do a few things, I can't remember the whole process, but they kind of had to treat it or clean it off or something because they didn't want it to be porous.
Uh-huh.
I don't know, but it looked pretty interesting.
Very cool.
That's right.
Awesome. Thanks, Richie.
Yeah.
Very interesting. And so Nate was going to talk a little bit about the tools he uses and they use to put the medium on the surface, put the paint on the canvas. Nate, can you just introduce yourself a little bit?
My name is Nate Closson. I actually hang out with Rich and Ken quite a bit. Do some plein air painting together. Nice. A lot of fun times.
Where are you from?
I'm from Whitefish. I grew up doing art as a kid. My mom's a watercolor artist. So from a young age, I was doing artwork and drawing. My day job is building custom cabinets, but I paint on the side.
It's my dad did.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. It's a great job, but I really like making art, so hopefully in the future.
Well, a custom cabinet can be its own work of art in some ways.
It's more craftsmanship than art, but
is.
Which I like doing, crafting things. But
mm-hmm.
It's not painting. It's not as nuanced as artwork. So I do mostly landscapes in oil, a lot of plein air stuff, and still just kind of searching for that style and subject matter that
I love. You're
supposed to paint
your water scenes, your ocean scenes. There's one behind us here. Is it sort of a homage to like John Singer Sargent? It looks familiar to me. Or when's
a lot of people would say Homer, probably.
Yeah, okay.
I don't really look at Homer stuff, but I guess it kind of turned out that way.
Yeah. That's beautiful.
Okay. Where's that? That is in the Bahamas, Long Island, one of the out islands in the Bahamas.
Yeah, you really capture that tropical light.
It's very bright.
Yeah.
Very high key. That water key.
Right.
Makes me want to dive in it.
Can you explain the high key versus low key concept? We talked a little bit about
it
last time.
In general, high key is like the top half of the value range, low key sort of the bottom half. And high key is just sort of my personal preference.
Okay.
I like brighter colors. And you know, most of the impressionist work is high key because you can see colors, true chroma, more in that middle to high range. It gets sort of hidden as you go towards the low end of the value scale. Ken always makes fun of me. My paintings are so high key.
What do you think on haiku?
Haiku?
Yeah. Is that
I don't really like
worse?
Haiku.
Oh.
They don't make any sense.
Okay.
But I like haiku.
It's really easy poetry to write.
It's
not good.
Cool. So as far as brushes,
and palette knives, and
I don't really use palette knives for painting. Okay. I've tried and I've seen Richard Schmidt do it in his DVDs, and it looks like it'd be very handy. But I feel pretty clumsy with it, so I kind of leave that just for scraping and cleaning and mixing.
Okay.
As far as brushes, I use a mix of bristle brushes, hog bristle brushes, and some mongoose. There's a company out of the UK called Rosemary. And tons of people use her brushes. Jeremy Lipking is
Richard.
One of Richard Schmidt, Daniel Keyes.
I have two of them.
Very
Richie Tight Key Carter does.
Yeah. You know, painters who are very respected and have a high level skill.
What are they made out of?
They were mongoose. And apparently Rosemary bought her stock of mongoose decades ago when it was still legal.
Wow.
And she just ran out within the last couple of years.
Really,
they're protected. Most of the mongoose come from India,
mm-hmm.
and they're protected now, which is good. But I've heard people say that in places like Hawaii, they're like a pest.
Right.
So I don't know if it's
they
a
were actually introduced to pest control.
Oh.
When the rats were all, I just heard this on my trip to Hawaii.
Oh.
They introduced mongoose to control the rats from all the ships dropping off
right.
the rats,
and it didn't go perfect.
Somehow, they have different schedules. So I believe while the mongoose hunted during the day,
right.
the rats were active at night, so they totally missed each other. So now they have both
ships
rats
passing
and
in the night.
Pest problem.
Thanks, humans.
So mongoose is kind of out, which is
big bar. Just get a ferret.
It is what it is.
Know what a mongoose looks like.
But those mongoose brushes are really nice. It's a little stiffer than a sable brush.
Okay.
But
sable's kind of for watercolor usually. Isn't
yeah,
it?
Watercolor and people use for acrylic, a lot of detail work.
Okay.
But the mongoose had a nice spring.
Right.
Like Ken and I are friends with Daniel Keyes, and watching him paint with a mongoose brush, like it kind of springs at the end of a stroke, and you can do crazy.
Yeah, the
edge
controls.
Unparalleled.
But those are kind of gone now.
Yeah.
I had some of them. I liked them a lot. You just have a little more finesse with edges using that. But the bristles I like because you can handle a little bit thicker paint load. And
you definitely like to.
Yeah,
paint
I like to put on some paint.
Yeah. I love
thick paint.
You use a lot of paint.
A lot of weight.
The best
and,
compliment you can give somebody.
And, yeah, that's our little inside joke. If you ever see a painting that you don't like in your, with the artist, you say,
I love how thick the paint is.
Okay.
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 Paint.
Good to know.
Yeah.
When
you can't
guys
think of anything
that.
Else to say,
I actually really do like how thick the paint is. I'm not just saying that.
I
love the lighting in here for this. It's really dark.
Well, thick paint to me indicates confidence and familiarity with
right.
the with the medium and yeah, just the bold. Those are my favorite pieces, the thick paint, bold
yeah.
strokes.
I think a nice combination of thick paint with some thin passages is sort of the most articulate way to paint in
cool.
general. But the bristles are nice because you can scratch through thick paint to let whatever's underneath show through a little bit, which is nice. Because I paint a lot of cool colors, probably too cool. Ken and I talk about this a lot.
Too cool.
Too cool.
Man.
Too much blue. Too much viridian.
Too much green.
But if you have a little bit of warm underpainting and you put
yeah.
a thick stroke with a bristle and you let some of it scratch through, you get this really kind of complex play between the cool and warm.
Mm-hmm.
Just by using the paint and the brush. So
what kind of underpainting? Underpainting is basically once you prime it, you put on, you tone the canvas with a certain color, depending on who you are and what do you favor as far as
toning? Usually it's dependent on kind of the major colors of the painting.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you do opposite, like if it's a real cool painting, you can do warm. Or if you want, you can do something similar. So if it's like mostly a green painting, you do kind of a warm green. That way you don't have to cover the entire canvas completely.
Right.
You can just let that stuff kind of be
yeah.
the filler between strokes. So I kind of just experiment with my underpainting. But it is nice sometimes when you're painting something really cool or really warm to have the opposite kind of show through your
strokes.
Absolutely.
Contrast.
Yes. Yeah. And something I've been doing recently is being a little more aggressive with wiping out stuff and using Q-tips to clean out a passage instead of trying to put in like thick white paint
to cover
or a lighter color, yeah.
Cool.
To clean it out first and then put something else in.
Okay. So you use Q-tips?
Q-tips, yeah. I have paper towels.
Fingers? You ever finger paint?
I use fingers a little bit.
Yeah. I don't want to use fingers a lot to just blend.
Yeah.
Blend color on canvas.
Q-tips are good.
Yeah.
And
it's so messy. I can't paint without getting paint all over my hands. I guess that
right.
comes with experience, but
that's toxic. I mean, if you use your Q-tips.
It is.
Sure. Don't eat a sandwich afterwards.
Yeah.
Some tortilla chips.
Cheetos.
Yep.
Like
Cheetos.
Yeah.
Oh.
I know
just don't eat Cheetos.
I think it was a French artist that I can't think of who it was, but he rolled cigarettes while he was painting, and that's what was his dye.
Yeah,
maybe that
guy
that cut his ear off. Hands
in your cigarette papers.
Yeah.
Really
add a little carcinogen to
a little extra
cocktail. Yeah.
Smoking a green cigarette now. Life is good.
Cool. Thanks, mate. Well, thanks
yeah.
for being here. Excited
you're
to have you and hope to bring you back and do some maybe a painting demo for us in
yeah,
the future if you're available. Lauren, did you want
to
talk about any alternative things that weren't mentioned as far as tools of the trade go?
I'm not sure what else I can add. I don't know.
Paper towels you mentioned, right? That's
yeah, I can use a lot of like anything it kind of takes to get what you're looking for, like paper towels, hands.
The texture as far.
Yeah,
what
just whatever. I've actually used makeup brushes before.
Yeah. Probably ruins them.
Yeah, they fall apart. Like,
right.
Because of the solids. But.
What did for application of paint or?
Yeah, like blending.
That's
okay. Yeah.
Little texture marks and
yeah.
stuff.
It's
yeah.
so that big one, Richie saw it.
Your.
Yeah, like those.
The blend?
Yeah, I actually used these like huge makeup brushes that are like $3, and that was the best thing I could find for that.
Yeah, we got to go to Lauren's studio yesterday for the first time, and she has some pretty awesome things going on there, and a lot of just, me and Kim are both saying how like she's like experimenting with different ways of working and some really old master's techniques mixed with just some more experimental modern things, and it's really cool to see like all the ways she's working and just trying stuff. And yeah.
Are you?
I work a lot like indirectly, so I think.
What do you mean?
Like layers, like visual optical mixing instead of like pigment mixing through layers, so.
Oh, I see. So like transparency, using the transparency of the. So do you mix a?
It's like just like a process of like an underlayer and then like a pistachio.
Bruce says, right? Yeah,
yeah,
and black and white. Or a,
yeah, and then like
an umber and white.
Another layer on top of that. So I'm kind of like experimenting.
Is that similar to glazing?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Which is mixing a little bit of pigment with a lot of medium and then putting it over. I don't know.
I think it gives it like a certain tone.
Sheet. Yeah, like, who's the artist? Russell Chatham, I think he's a famous Montana artist, does a lot of very atmospheric, with a lot of depth and not a lot of definition, but just kind of like receding trees and fields and things. And I think he uses a lot of glazing to achieve that depth.
It's like as a filmmaker using like little smoke on set, that sort of thing, maybe?
Machine.
Yeah,
sure.
Just to like, you know, so you can see the light coming through in
right.
various forms and adds more atmosphere.
Yes.
That is the comparison I'm making.
Cool. So, Ken, what are you working on and how's it going so far?
Well, I feel like I'm not working, but I'm actually matching right now the colors I used for my study were just little tiny pools of paint that are now dry. And so I'm trying to basically blow them up, making huge piles of paint for my commencement of this. I lied, except that this is where most of my work is done. I'm taking care of a lot of the brain processes I need to, and so now I can really relax and have more fun with the main piece, which is a kind of new thing for me. I used to not really do that too much, or without the color charts, I couldn't recreate the color exactly. So I went into even a large painting with a lot more timid, I just didn't really feel like I had any solid ground. And now these studies work, I like it, I'm gonna be able to make it big, and I know exactly how. And that's thanks to the color charts. So I'm basically just creating large piles of paint so I can go at this with everything ready. All my paints are pretty much ready now, I just gotta work on the darks. You can see how small the piles of paint were for the little piece and how big they are now for this one. And I'll be able to make them anymore. I know the combination that I used, and I just kind of look at the color chart balanced with the color I was using, and I can make as much of it as I want now. And
when you say balanced, you mean?
Well, there's like this one right now, I'm a little off still. You can see they're right next to each other, this tiny pool of paint, and this main large one I'm working on, there's slightly more orange in this one, and I want it to be a little pinker. So I can look at this color chart and see what I need to do to make it more pink, or if I get this more spot on. Traditionally, you want to mix as little, I mean, I guess it's how I work, but you want to use as few colors as possible into a mixture, so it'll make it look the more striking. If you, like, even if you're making a gray, if you want a, like, if I have my ivory black color chart here, I'll show you some of it, it'll be a more efficient way to get there, and even the grays will have patches where they're really clean and really concise, and if you're mixing five different colors into it, then it can start to look really muddy and it can get a little cloudy. Some artists really thrive with that look. Like Russell Chatham is one that really grays everything down, and he uses more complex ways of doing that, is my understanding. Like you can mix two complements to get a gray. So I can mix orange and blue and get a gray. And I can look at my color chart and see some of that. Ultramarine blue and cadmium orange is a much more gray blue. And this is more leaning towards the blue side even, but if I add more cadmium orange, it'll become even closer to gray. Or I could just add black and another color and get a gray. So
right.
It just depends on what you want to do.
And there's a lot of overlap with them.
Yeah, the color charts, you have to mix them when you're doing these. If someone's going to do these at home, definitely look at Richard Schmidt's book, All the Prima, to really get a lay of the land for how it's done. But if I'm going to mix, say, cadmium orange, this whole chart is going to lean more towards cadmium orange as I'm mixing it in. And then as I'm going to do ultramarine blue, you can see the ultramarine blue and cadmium orange passages, they're a lot different. So let's see where they are. This is cadmium orange here, and that one's ultramarine blue. So you can see the range you're getting out of those two based on what chart you're actually working on. There's to be no way to really know the limit of your colors. I mean, they're truly limitless and beautiful. And this is only two mixtures, but you can mix a third color in and really go nuts, but that'll give me an aneurysm. And I just think this is an already really complicated way to work, but it's nice to have it all laid out. So I'm trying to get that all pieced together so I can make a painting before your very eyes.
Cool. Well, I'm running out of time, so put some paint on them.
Okay, okay, all right, let's see. So, I guess, yeah, and they talked about doing washes over paintings, and I do that a lot. I'm not going to on this one, because I'm trying to encourage myself to paint thicker. And if I can, then if I have little holes everywhere, like some artists really thrive on that and it looks beautiful. I've never been able to pull it off. I feel like I got these unfinished patches that drive me crazy. So if I'm going to tone it, I think I'll notice the white more than I would a yellow or whatever color I put down. So I'll be able to just put down directly all the paint I want, right where I want it, and go fill it all in to a high degree of finish, hopefully.
Cool.
So.
Is it hard to mix the right amount of pigment?
Yeah, well, traditionally, like I said, originally, if I didn't have any idea how I got there, I mean, I would know a little bit, like, oh, it's blue, but I had a really bad tendency to just, like, mix blue skies and make them more green at the bottom, and that's how every sky is, and that's bad, I don't know, it's just not good painting to just, like, copy-paste everything. It doesn't make it exciting. That's not what nature's like.
Right.
Variance is really the main...
It's the spice of life.
Yeah, you gotta keep it fresh. So, like, right now, I'm putting a purple down that I would have never, ever put on a sky beforehand. Now I'm just like, woo, going nuts. But I know how to make that color, and so, but before that, I would try to mix that blue and make a huge pile of it so I never ran out. So if I ran out, I had no idea where I was going to get it again. Right. And now I know exactly what I'm going to do, so I can...
Thanks to color charts.
Yeah, thanks to color charts. Again, I'm being thrifty, because now I don't have to waste all this paint making unnecessarily huge piles of paint for fear of running out. I'm not worried about it at all, so I'm really... really pleased with that, but yeah, I do have a tendency to make too much, though. It's probably a habit I carried over, especially when working from life. I'll get the same panicky kind of sense, because it will change, especially for plain air. So I'll be like, okay, that's a general sky color, and just throw down a huge pile of it, and then I end up throwing away a lot of paint while I'm plain air painting. But sometimes, if you're going to do multiple paintings, like Nate and I, what a record is, like five paintings in one day?
Wow.
I think you did six.
Oh, yeah. So, like, when you're out there, like, we go up to Glacier Park, and you've already hiked in somewhere, you know you're going to, like, we found a glacier, anywhere you look is going to be a painting. Yeah. So you're really just trying to choose compositions you want, but the sky within that 1 hour probably won't change. So if I make a general sky color, it's kind of handy to pop up my kit. We go, you know, pack it all down, hike another mile, open it all up again, and I already have some pools of paint of some of the general colors that are around me in that general zone. So that can be helpful to overmix paint. And that's why I use a palette knife when I mix, even when I'm plein air painting. I feel like I can work, like, painting or juggling. And if you can keep one ball in the air at one time, you're going to be a little more efficient at it. And when you're trying to do everything at once, it really gets crazy. So if I mix paint and I'm just thinking about that color and value and not application, then I can go through and do application and really have my mind dedicated to that instead of, but I'm a simple brain kind of guy. I don't really... not known for my complex thinking. But yeah, the benefit of that, or Gazai, working with just value first, they'll do really complicated figures because they do every color, every edge, every brushwork. Like, you could just work on just the value and then move into everything else with a lot more confidence, knowing the value's right, which is the most important thing, right?
Yeah. Neat.
Yeah. So let's see, that's that. Light put down. Now I can go through with this big one. So this painting will come together a lot quicker now because I've done all this preliminary work and thought out a lot of things.
Nice.
I'm pretty excited about it. I won't have it done, but
yeah.
You can see it started a little bit here.
And this will go to Great Falls in March?
If I don't ruin it somehow, I've got definitely next month is the show in March, the Out West Art Show in Sale. And they're all west of some variety, and I kind of get mixed up sometimes.
What are the dates?
It's the 16th to the 19th. And...
at the Best Western Plus Heritage Inn?
Yeah, the Heritage Inn there.
Amazing show with a lot of great artists in it. A lot of Western work and a lot of other work, too.
Yeah, and it's all based off of the Charlie Russell auction, which is a really big draw. And I'm hopefully able to go watch it this year if I can. It's always pretty crazy. But... yeah, I really wanted to do something that was fitting the Western theme there. I usually do a lot of more just contemporary landscapes from observation, mostly because I love them and I think other people love them. So I do that, but this is a little more narrative. Like, that made it all up out of my head because of what I was hearing in a song and the imagery that I see around Montana that fit it, and I'm hoping it resonates with people.
It reminds me a bit, the composition and the subject reminds me a bit of a Michael Lomonti.
Oh yeah, yeah. Well,
the lone cowboy.
And I think he will do a lot of that where he just narrates a story. He narrates something and it's just not like he has to go out and set figures up. Like, he really knows how to just capture what's essential. And the main inspiration for a lot of this style of work was actually N.C. Wyeth.
Mm-hmm.
He's one of the great illustrators of all time. And they could work with a lot less. And I was starting to feel like I was really dependent on photographs and I don't like that.
Right.
And this is really refreshing to do something that's just purely design. Really, it's not a lot of other elements at play in this.
Yeah. But yeah, Mike Gunty has figured out how to weave a narrative of historical interest into those, because he's interested in history and he's interested in painting, and his titles alone are usually a couple sentences long.
Yeah.
And then there's another paragraph or two about what he was thinking about, what historical event he was thinking about when it happened, and one was called The Four Riders of the Apocalypse, and it was
a straight up Johnny Cash song.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's great.
Ken, tell us what you did to your brush.
Oh, I raged on it. I
I didn't hear this story.
No, what happens, you get all these different brushes. I like to experiment a lot. I wish I could buy all rosemary brushes and really know what I'm getting into, but at this point, I'm still playing a lot with application, and so I bought this brush, which happened to have like a 2-foot handle on it, and I really wanted to put it in my little plein air kit, and it's just a smaller brush container, so it like fits in my backpack, and it didn't quite fit. So I'm like, usually we're getting ready to go at 5 in the morning to go to Glacier Park. It's like, I want this brush in here, and snap it off, and it's a brush that fits.
That's cool.
I wish I didn't have to do that, but
Monet, when his sight started going, he used a 10-foot brush to paint like the lilies, the water lilies, I think. Yeah.
Website?
What?
His website? when he first got that up and running, Monet was really good at web development.
Yeah.
I heard that.
Bill Gates learned a lot from him.
Well, I think next week we'll talk a bit about the art business and those other electronic tools of the trade. How to get your work out there, and one of those big parts of that, for at least in this art market, is going to shows like the one in March in Great Falls, and like our show in Bozeman in August, and in September in Coeur d'Alene. Really gives artists a chance to meet collectors, develop relationships, and get exposure to a new area, new buyers.
Well, new artists too has been a huge thing for me, meeting certain people. I didn't even really know you until the show in March. Started being able to hang out more when you're there.
Yep.
It's good camaraderie.
It's the only times that a bunch of artists get together in one place, usually. It's outside of paint outs and things, but.
And even really, like, I met even super high caliber artists that weren't necessarily even in that show. There was the big auctions around there, and you're able to, I got to shake Clyde Asbury's hand. Which was like he's one of my all-time heroes. I just creepily stood behind him as he was talking to somebody else until the conversation over with. I shook his hand, that's all I care about.
Awesome.
Yeah, real cool. Wouldn't have been possible if I wasn't there.
Yeah, well, the Charlie Russell Museum in Great Falls brings in a lot of big names, big, great artists. It's quite an honor to be invited.
Yeah, it's good stuff.
Great. Well, I think I'd love to watch Ken continue to paint, but
sorry it took so long.
About an hour, no, it's okay.
He's almost done though.
Yeah, this it really won't. Once this is going that way, it's just filling in things. You just start walking down. I'm gonna do the shadows first because they're the, and this is the sky. Well, in this painting particularly is the shadow. There's the darkest dark is still the foreground and the dirt and everything that's gonna make the foreground. But I started the sky because that's where my biggest shapes are. It would help me see if I need to change the drawing. I didn't grid or like photocopy anything over. I just looked at the piece and tried to transfer it. Already I can see the clouds a little different, so I might rearrange some of those. But the darks are easier to paint over. They'll dry quicker, and then you can really slop down the juicy stuff. So hopefully,
nice sound of that.
Yeah, hopefully I don't have to. Hopefully this is already a masterpiece, but usually it doesn't work that way.
Well, to follow Ken. It's Kenneth Yarus Fine Art on Facebook and Instagram.
Yep. Well, yeah, I think it might just be Kenneth Yarus on Instagram, but it's all tied to my art. I need to put a link up on my website, everything too.
You've been doing a really good job posting a lot of your progress on online, and it's fun to watch.
Thanks.
So keep it up. And Richie Carter, Fine Art.
Fine Arts.
Fine
yep.
Arts.
Yep.
On
Facebook and Instagram.
Instagram. My own Morgan Cawdrey, Fine Art on Facebook, and at MCAWD, MCAWD, on Instagram. Lauren is currently private, private account on Instagram, but
Lauren,
she might let you follow her if you're lucky.
LO_RUN.
Okay, thanks. And next time you should bring some of your work up and we can show the camera. And Nate, are you on social media at all?
Yeah, Nate Closson, Fine Art on Instagram.
Perfect.
Are we friends on Instagram?
Mm-hmm.
Did I follow you?
Are you on Instagram?
Yeah.
With that phone?
As of 2 weeks ago, I got a
phone. Oh, that will start following you
yeah,
today.
Yeah, we gotta follow each other.
Nice.
He's modernized.
Thanks for listening, and, oh, sorry, and Dan
oh,
Williams.
Nice.
Yeah.
My bad.
Right, my Instagram, Wild Animal Isle. Aisle like island, not grocery store aisle, but you know, got my photography and some drawings and other arts and stuff. You know, I use it for art purposes, so it's worth checking out.
Good. My
so,
account? Where's your phone?
Oh, Billy the character, yeah. I discovered this new app, the Face Swap Alive. My life will never be the same. It's great.
You want to check that out?
Definitely check it out.
I like Face Swap fails. Those are fun.
But it'll take like any picture and like it'll just like map to your face. So it's really good for impressions of celebrities, which I've been doing. I'll show you afterwards. It's fun. I'm having a blast.
Awesome. Thanks for listening. Thanks to all of our participants, and
yeah,
we'll be
guys.
Back in 2 weeks.
Well,
all right. Thank you.